Imagine a world that is very different from today. A world where there are no public galleries full of colourful paintings. Where the names of great men like Leonardo da Vinci and Michelangelo are hardly known. Where art is considered purely decorative and the artist a mere craftsman.
It's astonishing, yet this was Britain 400 years ago. Since then, great works of art have flooded onto British shores and our appreciation of art and artists has been transformed. This is the story of the private collectors who brought a wealth of treasures from overseas, whose patronage encouraged British-born artists, and whose personal passion for art and individual taste helped create this cultural revolution and shape the artistic direction of our nation.
In this programme, I'll be looking at the golden age of collecting in the 18th century. Before this, just a handful of privileged men and women had travelled abroad, developing a pioneering passion for art. But now, this enthusiasm spread throughout the entire aristocracy, who began importing the very best European paintings by the shipload.
They've got gold and they've got silver, and you know, people are quite happy to take that. Mm-hmm.
I'll explore how the appreciation of art offered a new form of cultural currency. And as their collections grew, art lovers like Thomas Cook created grand country seats to display them.
Houses like this were built for show.
I'll see how the rich and powerful Dukes of Richmond at Goodwood House supported the revolutionary idea that the view from a window could be a worthy subject for a painting. And how Petworth House and the third Earl of Egremont, its bohemian owner, helped establish the painters who would become the great masters of British art. London, at the dawn of the 18th century. The Act of Union between England and Scotland had created a new nation, Great Britain, poised to enjoy a period of peace and prosperity. In this newly affluent age, the leading patrons of the arts would not be the monarchy, but Britain's landed gentry, more numerous and more wealthy than ever before.
A powerful new breed of connoisseur collector was emerging. A culturally informed aristocrat who would use art to define status. It was their money and their taste that would shape the artistic direction of this nation.
This was a time when young aristocrats were expected to earn their cultural credentials with a grand tour of Europe, often lasting several years. With a tutor to keep them on the straight and narrow, Italy was a favourite destination. They took in all the major sites and art galleries, including the Uffizi in Florence and the Colosseum in Rome. It was essential to return with an enviable collection of artwork as proof you'd matured into a person of taste and discernment. And there was one man who, more than any other, embodied this new, culturally confident age. Celebrated by his peers as England's Apollo of the arts, Richard Boyle, 3rd Earl of Burlington, returned from his grand tour with enough treasures to fill 800 trunks. Inspired by the work of the Italian Renaissance architect Palladio, he built this magnificent Thameside villa, not to live in, but to house his newly acquired collection. Burlington's neo-Palladian style, with its restrained facades and rational planning, became a hallmark of 18th century Britain. This unique marriage of art and architecture set the benchmark for every serious British collector. The tasteful display of your art would become a sign of social status and intellectual sophistication. While most of Burlington's collection has now been dispersed, numerous British aristocrats would follow his example on a much grander scale, showing off the highlights of their collection in country retreats, often extended or even specially built for the purpose. Agricultural wealth pouring into East Anglia at this time funded the construction of Holcombe Hall in Norfolk. This great Palladian villa was created in the 1730s under Burlington's supervision for Thomas Cook, who later became 1st Earl of Leicester. The house was conceived as the perfect setting for Cook's art collection, and it embodies the taste of a new generation of 18th century connoisseurs. Today, great works by the 17th century masters such as Rubens hang at Holcombe because Cook's grand tour lasted 6 years, making it the longest in history. He bought Van Dyck's and picked out the very best paintings and statues by the Italian artists like Guido Reni.
There were many great collections being built up at this time, but what makes Holcombe stand out for me is the way that house and collection grew together. It's the perfect grand tour house, built in the style and spirit of the age.
But Thomas Cook wasn't always a studious and refined art lover. His parents died when he was just 10 years old, and Cook was adopted by his grandparents, who took his education very seriously. When he became a little too keen on hunting and cockfighting, they sent him off on the obligatory cultural tour overseas. The current Viscount Cook and his family still live here at Holcombe, where the archives contain a fascinating personal account of how the boisterous young Cook was seduced by the art of Italy.
You get the impression that he really caught the grand tour bug in a big way.
Yes, absolutely. Mm. This is a letter which we have, which he wrote in 1714, so a year in, from Rome to his uncle. I have become, since my stay at Rome, a perfect virtuoso and a great lover of pictures, even so far as to venture to encroach on the kindness of my guardians in having bought some few.
So it really sounds as if he was just asking for more pocket money.
Yes, and thankfully it was given because he was able to buy yet more treasures.
And I suppose then at this point he realised that he needed to create somewhere to put all the things that he bought.
Yes, I mean, houses like this were built for show, to show off to the public and to visitors and to your guests. Your collection and vis-a-vis your learning and knowledge, really.
The pioneering collectors that travelled to Europe 100 years previously favoured the great Renaissance artists like Titian and Leonardo da Vinci. But demand soon outstripped supply, inflating prices beyond what most buyers were prepared to pay. To prevent Italy being completely stripped of its treasures, Italian authorities imposed laws, making old masters almost impossible to export. So the art lovers of Thomas Cook's generation began to develop broader tastes.
By the time Cook set off on his grand tour, the art market was leading prospective picture buyers in a new direction, and certain previously overlooked artists were becoming the new collectibles. Rome, with its ancient ruins, was one of the highlights of the grand tour. And here, British travellers were enchanted by the work of the 17th century classical painter Claude, who had long been a favourite among Roman cardinals. And no one more so than Thomas Cook. The landscape room here at Holkham is a real gem of British collecting. It contains one of the finest groups of Claude's work in private hands, still hung exactly as it was in Thomas Cook's day. At first glance, we might think these are simply pastoral scenes. But in Cook's day, collectors wanted more than that. The narrative aspect of a painting was still very important, and each of these actually depicts a scene from classical mythology. Claude was a very methodical painter, using certain building blocks, such as the lone tree, the classical ruin, and the distant mountains, again and again in his paintings. His skill was in arranging these into a different composition each time, creating a series of imaginary landscapes.
Claude had really stumbled across the perfect formula to appeal to the 18th century English aristocrat, because his paintings combine the viewer's desire for intellectual content by their all-important references to classical narratives with the beautiful landscape background.
Claude's carefully composed images of nature inspired a new fashion for landscape gardening amongst the aristocracy, who tried to emulate these scenes on their country estates. As an early collector of Claude's work, Thomas Cook was paving the way for the new genre of landscape painting, which would become such an important part of the story of art in this country. Thomas Cook continued to collect art for the house right up until his death in 1759. At a time when Britain had no national art gallery, the cultural influence of private collections like this was significant. A personal invitation to visit somewhere like Holkham was the only opportunity most people would ever get to see really first-class art in this country. The house and the influential collection that remains here are Thomas Cook's lasting legacy.
The remarkable thing about the 18th century was that passionate art lovers like Thomas Cook were not a one-off. This has become known as the golden age of British collecting, with very good reason. It was a time when our pursuit of art reached fever pitch, and many wealthy aristocrats were dedicating themselves and their considerable fortunes to the cause.
In a boom year like 1725, the British imported over 750 paintings and 6,000 prints from Italy alone. Such was the enthusiasm for art, there was even a new gentlemen's club founded by and for British collectors. The Society of Dilettanti, of which Thomas Cook was an early member, allowed grand tourists to develop the artistic knowledge they'd gained abroad upon their return home. It was also a riotous all-male club. Horace Walpole observed that the nominal qualification is having been in Italy, and the real one being drunk in Rome. Historian Jeremy Black has spent many years studying this particularly vibrant period.
So here we are at the Uffizi, and you really get the idea. It's the golden age of collecting, don't you? They all look so passionate about what they're doing.
Well, they're certainly passionate. In fact, you'll notice them all gazing there at the nude. You see a number of features here. First of all, you've got a lot.